Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Physicists, Metaphysics, and Frauds. My name's Grace Denman, and this is my husband, Chip Denman. We are founding members of the National Capital Area Skeptics and have been on the board of directors since its inception. We're also involved with the JREF. Chip is on the board of directors, and I am an advisor and friend of the organization. So welcome. We're very happy to have you with us. Today's discussion begins with a history of NCAS, in a sense. In the spring of 1987, Jamie Ian Swiss and I, along with two gentlemen who are no longer on the earthly plane, formed the National Capital Area Skeptics. And one of our first events was in that fall to put on a theatrical seance, which was great fun. We were inspired by a magician from Chicago and had a great theater experience. But our next seance experience was very, very different. It was indeed a seance in suburban Virginia. There was an advertisement the next fall. Come to the seance for a small fee. You could join the circle. And Chip and I and another friend, Randy Lockwood, also an NCAS member, decided we were curious and we wanted to go. And so we called, we reserved our space, and we were told that we could each invoke one person that we were trying to meet, someone on the other side. And so we did a little strategizing and picked kind of different perspectives. I chose to try to talk to my grandmother Kennedy, who had just passed, a real person that I knew extremely well. Chip chose to talk to John Mulholland, who was a famous magician, a friend of Houdini, a real person whom he'd never met. And our friend Randy chose to make up an uncle that never existed that he was trying to visit. And at the same time, within that context of those roles, we decided to be honest. Like, within that, we weren't going to break the rules during the evening. And so we went to suburban Virginia, you know, to the rec room in these ladies' basement in a circle, and each of us, in turn, had a visit from the person we were going to visit. You know, they missed us, all was well, they hoped they were with us. Now, in the context of our three roles, that could only be a hit for one of us, and that was me. It couldn't be a hit for either Chip or for Randy. But what we found interesting at this seance is at the break, many of the sitters, as well as our hostesses, took out pendulums. Very much like this one, since crystals were big at that time. And so, within the context of the break, they were asking each other questions, and the spirits were speaking through the pendulum to those questions. There were also other sitters who had brought items, sentimental items from people that they lost, that the hostesses were holding the pendulums over to answer specific questions about those lost people. So it was very interesting to us that it was part of the event, in a sense. And we were the odd men out and the odd woman out, clearly. So pendulums have been used through history. In the early, you know, Roman days, they were used with a wheel or with letters to help spell out answers to questions. These are not new objects. But I would like to try an experiment, a demonstration with six of you. I've brought six pendulums. So if six of you are feeling particularly positive because the movement of pendulums, especially with people who don't believe in magic and mysticism, is really reliant on a positive attitude. And so I would like to invite six people to please join me. Anyone feeling positive?
Very positive.
Hello, Laura. AJ, do you want to join us? The first six people win.
I see, I'm going to adjust your mic. Every time you turn away from it.
Okay, I actually have eight, so if we have seven. Now, Now, I didn't prepare you pendulums quite as pretty as the one I brought for myself.
Have them face the audience.
Say again?
Have them face the audience.
Oh, yes, I will. Good point. Chip has reminded me that you should be facing the audience and not me. Ta-da.
Thank you.
And any of you that are jealous can create these pendulums with a short trip to Home Depot.
It's a wash.
So, well, what I want to suggest is that you hold your pendulum out at arm's length, and I don't want you to try to move it. I don't want you to try to stop moving it. What I want you to do is, in your mind's eye, see the pendulum moving clockwise. In your mind's eye, think about how it would feel if the pendulum started to move. Holly has some motion there. And Mouse, a great name, is also moving. Think about how it would feel to see it move. We have some movement from Josh. Laura's not as positive as she thought she was.
It must be because I'm thinking Australia. It goes the other way.
Direction isn't really important. It's motion. So at least for three of our skeptics, there is some transmission.
The one in the middle in particular, that one's really starting to move a little bit there. And you know, no, this is great. I mean, it's hard to not have it happen. All skeptics here, so we kind of have an expectation that it shouldn't happen, but it really is a natural thing. It's something that we hardly can control. It's part of our ideomotor system, where if we think it, if we see it, it's hard to stop it from happening.
Imagine it moving in your head, AJ. Concentrate in your mind's eye. I know you're tired. You've traveled a long distance. Okay. You shouldn't be annoyed.
Right.
This is a very rational, normal thing, and it's really, there's no mysticism, there's no magic. It's the way our minds work.
And that's great. That's exactly.
Excuse me.
Okay.
So, anyway, you're certainly welcome to keep your pendulums, and later, as you are trying to meet and grow closer to your fellow skeptics, you can use it to ask yes-no questions. And if the answer is yes, it will move back and forth. Oh. And if it's no, it'll go sideways.
Okay. Doesn't it also predict baby sexes?
In some
they have a 50%
liability.
Exactly. That's pretty good. That's better than chance, isn't it?
So
I'm a statistician. I'll vouch for that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So I am passing the mantle to Chip.
Talk about later on. Ask him to think about how you test it.
Oh, okay. That's a good point. So later we're going to come back to this question, so it's not really a Q&A right now. But think about how you might actually test the pendulum effect. How would you know if it was magic or not? How would you know what was causing the movement? So just think about that, and we'll get back to it later when we get to the workshop portion of the day.
Great. So I'm not used to using a Mac, so let's see, what do I need to do to get things there? There we go. All right, so Grace talked a little bit about our seance experiences, and I have been fascinated with seances since I was a kid. You know, we see this stuff on TV. Maybe you remember the TV show from a couple of years ago, Medium, or maybe you saw something on some late night movie with people sitting around in a darkened room, holding hands around a table, trying to evoke the spirits of the ones they had lost, just like Grace described at the seance we went to in Virginia. Well, where does that idea come from? Where in the world did we get the idea that we could do something like that? Well, not to put too fine a point on it,
But seances, as I'm describing them, began, the history of that began on the evening of March 31st, 1848. Yeah, so I'm gonna talk very briefly about the history of seances and mediums and spiritualism, and that's gonna lead us into a further discussion of pendulums and some other phenomena that scientists of the day became interested in testing, and testing from the physical sciences side. So we'll talk a little bit about how those tests work, and before our time here is over, we'll be asking you folks to design some tests for some more modern phenomena. So that's where we're going. So in a sense, talking to the spirits has been around for as long as there have been humans talking to each other. There is some evidence that early man may have had some kind of a sense of the afterlife and the supernatural. But I'm really talking about this very modern, almost modern, idea of evoking the spirits under your control as a medium or as a sitter at a seance. And that's the history that I want to describe here. But first, a little bit of context. What was going on in the mid-1800s? Well, that was a time when science and technology were advancing by leaps and bounds. Electricity and magnetism were the vogue, and any sort of mysterious phenomena might have been, they tried to explain it in terms of electricity and magnetism. This was the time that Samuel Morse was demonstrating his telegraph, that at the top there it was his first test message sent to Congress from Baltimore, what hath God wrought? And the spiritualist of that day picked up on the fact that communication through some mysterious means, invisible force like electricity, was a lot like what they were trying to do. And they even named some of their publications the Spiritual Telegraph. So it was an age when all sorts of things were changing. There were revolutions in Europe. It was a gold rush in California. It was a time when in upstate New York, people were investigating all sorts of things from mesmerism to spiritualism to Mormonism. Upstate New York at the time was kind of the California of its day. It was the hotbed of esoteric and philosophical exploration. Mesmer here, I'll just say a couple of words. This was his idea. We has sort of evolved into what we think of as mesmerism or hypnotism today, but his concept was that we all have a certain amount of, he called it animal magnetism, a force that some people he thought could control, and he thought he could really control it. So you see in this drawing here of him projecting these magnetic force fields to the patient he's working on. So as far as I've been able to determine, the word seance itself began not with spiritualism, but with mesmerism, with people sitting around at home, sitting, the French word for sitting, seance. Folks would sit and experiment with animal magnetism and mesmerism. That set the stage for folks to experiment with other sorts of things. And this fellow emerged, who was a mesmerist. He claimed to be a clairvoyant. And he was an author of what proved to be a very influential work to set the stage for spiritualism. I want to quote very briefly from this seminal work of his called The Principles of Nature, Her Divine Revelations and a Voice to Mankind, published in 1847, in which he said, "It is a truth that spirits commune with one another while one is in the body and the other is in the higher spheres. And this truth will ere long present itself in the form of a living demonstration, and the world will hail with delight the ushering in of that era when the interiors of men will be opened and the spiritual communion will be established, such as is now being enjoyed by the inhabitants of Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn." Okay, well, never mind. What he was trying to say was, get ready, world. We are about to see the next great step in spiritual evolution. We are about to find the ones who will let us break through the veil and communicate with the other side. So the world was indeed ready for three sisters from upstate New York. Hydesville, New York doesn't really exist anymore, although Grace and I found the place where this house used to stand. We took a little field trip near Rochester and even went to the county library where the local historian drew us maps, and we found the crossroads where this house had stood. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the fellow who invented the ultra-scientific detective Sherlock Holmes, said of this particular moment, this was one of the great points in psychic evolution. Little Kate Fox, age 6 or 7, we think, her sister Maggie, a year or two older, had been hearing weird sounds in the farmhouse at night. But on this particular evening, things took a dramatic turn. They were sent to bed. Dark night in March, upstate New York, you know, not a lot of things to do. They were sent to bed early, but after a few minutes, they called to their mother and said, come here, there's something going on. So the mother went in, Mrs. Fox went in, her name was also Margaret, went in, and here's what happened. Little Kate pointed to the dark corner of their bedroom and said, Mr. Splitfoot, do as I do. And she clapped her hands 3 times. And from that dark corner, those three women, those two girls and their mother, heard an answering, Mr. Splitfoot. Little Maggie picked up on the idea and pointed to the corner and said, do as I do. But this time, Maggie didn't actually clap her hands, she just made the motion. But guess what? Splitfoot still answered. I can just imagine how good Mrs. Fox must have shivered in that cold, dark room. It turns out that through a series of rapping sounds, these two young girls developed a code and found out that they could communicate with this spirit, who ultimately, through their messaging, said that he was the spirit of a peddler who had been murdered in that house at some point. They didn't say exactly when. Word spread like wildfire, or people came from all over the county to witness this phenomena, and the girls really kind of were the focal point for this. They really seemed to enjoy the attention. They would do this demonstration, and it got so bad that a fellow who had been a previous tenant of the house even issued an official public statement that no, he was not a murderer. He had not done this evil deed. But at some point, it must have gotten a little bit out of hand. And they sent, that is, Mr. and Mrs. Fox, sent the two young girls away to sort of maybe break the cycle and calm things down for the neighborhood. So they sent them to stay with their much older sister, Leah, who lived in Rochester at the time. And guess what? That pesky spirit. Spirits! That pesky spirit followed them to Rochester. And older sister Leah had the brilliant marketing idea that we can actually sell tickets. And so they started charging admission. People would come to the home, and thus the first commercial seances were held. This whole idea really caught on, and it didn't take long for other people to discover that they too had this ability. So within a few years, there were over 2,000 practicing mediums in the United States alone, and then it traveled across the pond to England, where it caught on there just as well. So there's a rich, rich history of this this whole phenomena, and I would love to give a whole talk on that sometime. I'm going to give you the very compressed version, but it's worth saying that these two young girls made a living, and they grew to adulthood and became celebrities. They traveled to England and gave seances there, and things were pretty good. Oh, but I have to say, there were skeptics. There were those who said, nah, I don't think so. There was a committee of doctors in Buffalo, New York, who got permission and examined the girls and saw them do their demonstration, and they came back with a rather skeptical conclusion that it wasn't spirits, that it was the girls cracking their knee joints. So not too many people paid attention to that. They went on, they actually rented a large theater in Rochester, the Corinthian Hall, where they charged $1 a person, which was not a cheap ticket at the time, and demonstrated their abilities on stage, the ability to seemingly get these mysterious rapping or cracking sounds to appear at their command and use them to answer messages from the spirits. So, as I said, they grew to adulthood, they traveled to England, and at one point, it seems that life was not always easy. On the return trip in 1888, Maggie Fox, now an adult and somewhat discouraged with the way things had been going for her in England, met up with a reporter for a New York newspaper, the New York Herald, and promised him an exclusive interview after they arrived back in New York. And here's what she said. She confessed that she and her sister, from the start, had faked it all. She said her big toe did it all. Those doctors in Buffalo weren't so far off, but it wasn't their knee joints. They'd learned to crack their toes in such a way that they could even use the floorboards as resonators to make it seem even louder and more mysterious than it might have been. She said that very first night in the bedroom when they fooled her mother, they had tied an apple to a string and, under cover of the darkness, tugged on the string to bounce the apple on the floorboards and create Mr. Splitfoot. So she confessed. She even went on stage in New York and did a public demonstration with her sister attending and supporting. They tried to come clean. It didn't really work out too well for them. No one wanted to pay admission to see how they'd been tricked. The expose tour that they had planned flopped. Guess what? They recanted. The confession, they said, was a fake. They'd been forced into it. And so they went on to the rest of their lives, not the celebrities that they had been, but they managed to eke out a survival. Kate died from alcoholism. Maggie died a year or two later, also destitute and in a pretty bad way. And to their deathbed, they blamed their older sister, Leah, for having set them up and put them on that path that led them to this sham of a life. So, but what I'd like to do is fast forward through some of the other folks who discovered their mediumistic gifts. As I said, by 1852, there were over 2,000 mediums practicing in the United States. This is an example of a different kind of mediumistic phenomena of a spirit photographer. Some of the folks discovered that they didn't just communicate through rapping sounds, but they could even photograph the ghost. If you look closely, behind Mary Todd Lincoln, there is the shadowy figure of the president after his assassination. There was a photographer by the name of William Mumler in Boston who produced photos like this, but he was not alone. He was perhaps the best known, but this whole industry sprang up of ghostly photographs capturing the images of those that you had lost. As for the president himself, Mary Todd Lincoln had actually been an avid spiritualist even before her husband had been killed. She brought mediums to the White House. She had seances conducted there, and it seems that the president attended some of those. There is a story. It's perhaps apocryphal, but it's such a wonderful expression that I will pass it on anyway. It is said that someone asked the president what he thought of the seance that he had just attended. And he said, "Well, for those that like that sort of thing, I suppose it's exactly the sort of thing they would like." So So, but by this time, mediums had gone on to many, many other ways of communicating with the spirits, not just through rapping sounds. Here, I'm going to give credit to one doctor, well, we use the term loosely, Dr. Henry Slade, who gets credit for being the first, I believe, to communicate with the spirits through writing. He discovered that he could, in a seance room with the lights turned down, have a what had been a blank school slate, like you see in the picture, appear a little while later with a message written on it in chalk from the spirits. The photo here actually contains a message, and it took me a while before I was able to decipher the handwriting, but what it says there is, "Your slate is too small for our use. We will do more someday soon. Signed, WW. So this was one of the spirit messages captured from one of his seances. But the main reason I want to talk about him today is that he was willing to be tested by the scientists. And in 1877, he brought himself to Professor Johann Carl Friedrich Zollner, who was a mathematician and astrophysicist. His area of study led him to be very, very interested in higher dimensional mathematics. And he came to believe that if there were indeed spirits, they were operating through a fourth dimension, a fourth physical dimension that we did not have access to. And so he believed that many of the spiritualist phenomena, like slate writing, were being accomplished not by trickery, but by spirits who could manipulate our three dimensions by reaching out from their fourth. And so he was tested by, Slade and was very, very favorably impressed. Now, mind you, he had his own critics, and there are those that said that Zollner was, this was relatively late in his career, that he may not have been completely in the right mind or the clearest thinker. And in fact, he did die, I believe, 3 or 4 years later from a brain aneurysm. So, you know, perhaps he wasn't thinking the most clearly, but he nonetheless was an early scientist who was willing to sit down with a medium and do a physical test to see if it would work the way he wanted. One of the things that they did was that Slade took a rope that had been braided together into a continuous loop, and he put it around his neck, and then, you know, during the seance, they turn out the lights. You know, that was one of the interesting things to me, was that in these seances, the darker the room got, the cooler the phenomena became. So in this particular case, when the lights came back up, the rope, mysteriously, had several knots inside it, which would have been impossible in just our three dimensions. And so this, among a few other things, were kind of the clinchers for Zollner, who really became convinced that there was a fourth dimensional agent working here. Slade found his way to England, where things went less well. Once he was in England, there were several other scientists who took an interest in him. I'm mentioning Wallace for a reason. Wallace, as you probably know, was the co-discoverer of the theory of natural selection, the idea that evolution, species evolved through a mechanism of natural selection, discovered this independently of Darwin. And we don't hear much of him today in the same way we hear about Darwin. I think there's a reason for that relating to the spiritualist movement. He was an avid spiritualist. When Slade was hauled before the magistrate in the courts of London and accused of fraud by two other scientists who said that they believed that Slade was just doing magic tricks, Wallace came to Slade's defense and testified as a character witness on his behalf. He didn't actually do tests, as far as I know. He had already been convinced in principle and felt that Slade was the sort of upstanding fellow who wouldn't be cheating. But Wallace defended while two other scientists challenged. Ultimately, Slade was convicted, but then the conviction was overturned on a technicality. It seems that the law that had been invoked to charge him was a law prohibiting fortune-telling, not spirit communication per se. And so he actually never received any true penalty for what he had done. But here we see two sides of the scientific community. One side, two scientists who challenged the spiritualist, and another eminent scientist who embraced them. And this was not that uncommon at that day. Spiritualism was a phenomena of interest, whether you were a skeptic or a believer. And that was true in the scientific community as well. It was at least considered something worth investigation by many. Which brings us to Florence Cook, a medium in Britain, who became known as perhaps the most adept medium for producing physical phenomena, actual materializations, having a ghost walk around the seance room. She was associated with a spirit, many spirits, but the one most associated with her was what she called her spirit guide, a ghost by the name of Katie King. Katie King was supposedly the spirit of the daughter of the pirate Henry Morgan. Got all that? So Katie King would appear at Florence's seances and sometimes walk around, sometimes be photographed, sometimes cut off locks of her hair as souvenirs. And it was an amazing thing. But she had she actually approached one of the most prominent young physicists of the day, Sir William Crookes, and asked him if he would please conduct a series of rigorous tests of her ability. Now, why in the world would a seance medium, whom we skeptics might naturally think is trying to pull tricks, why would a medium like that put herself in the situation of being tested by a scientist, a physicist, like William Crookes? Well, she had had, shortly before this, a somewhat unfortunate event. There had been a seance that had not gone well. When the lights had gone out and the spirit walked about the room, one of the rude sitters in the parlor had the audacity to reach out and grab the ghost. A bit of wrestling ensued, and eventually the spirit broke free and retreated to the back area, what they call the spirit cabinet, behind a curtain. And a few minutes later, a somewhat dazed and disheveled Florence emerged, and end of story. This was fairly damaging to her career. It has been suggested that she went to Crookes because Crookes was known to be sympathetic. She went to this sympathetic scientist and asked to be tested in the hopes that she could sort of get back in the good graces of the world. If she could convince this prominent physicist, well, maybe that one event wouldn't be such the disaster that it had looked like. So Crookes agreed, and he actually took her into his home and conducted a series of experiments that lasted almost a year. And he never actually issued an official statement one way or the other, but from his correspondence, it looks to his friends, it looks as if he was more or less impressed, perhaps until the very end. The fact that things ended so suddenly suggests, but this is speculation on my part, that perhaps he started to get suspicious and decided to terminate things before there was an out-and-out exposure. I don't know, but it just seems odd that things suddenly came to the halt that they did without him ever saying anything more. I want to put a picture up here. This was a photo taken during one of his seance tests in his own home of the spirit Katie King walking with him, their arm in arm. I will leave it to your own call how much of a resemblance there might be between Katie King and Florence herself. There is, I think Crookes is an interesting example of someone who, let's see, here we go. Sorry about that. Crookes was an interesting example of a highly trained scientist who I think, had a little too much hubris. He maintained to many of his colleagues that a trained scientist, a trained physicist, was completely up to the challenge of detecting any trickery from a professional conjurer. Now, I kind of live in both worlds. I'm not a performing magician, but I have studied a little bit. I've worked with some of the folks here that you've probably seen perform. And so I know a little bit about magic and how easy it is for a smart person to get fooled. I think Crookes was a little too smart. He was someone that believed that his scientific training was the same thing as being trained in deception. And I will tell you, I don't think that's the case at all. There was an interesting correspondence between him and one of his friends, where he was describing a session with one of these spirit photographers who had taken photos of a ghost. And he wrote a letter in which he said, "It does my heart much good to see this evidence. The photos had been taken, and at no time did the medium handle the camera or the photographic plate. It does my heart much good to see this strong evidence." And that's a pretty clear, strong statement. However, 10 days prior to that, he'd written another letter to the same individual describing the same event. And in that earlier letter, it came across a little differently. He said the photographer, the medium, had not handled the camera or the plate, except for the moment when he took it out and reinserted it into the camera. It seems that Crookes did not appreciate how that subtle little point, there was indeed a moment when the photographer handled the plate, but that was so insignificant to him, he didn't see it as meaningful to the investigation, and by 10 days later, he'd completely forgotten about it entirely. So by this particular time, one of the phenomena that scientists got interested in testing was the phenomena known as table tipping or table turning, where people would sit around in the parlor, often in their own homes, put their hands on top of a lightweight table, and ask the spirits to come forward. And many times, after a little while, the table would start to shake, rock a little bit, move back and forth. Sometimes they could even use it like a pendulum to ask questions of the spirits and get an answer in code. However, it's worth noting that there are many ways to make a table tip. And what I want to call your attention to here is the gentleman sitting facing us all who's lifted up his boot underneath the table to give it a shove. Now, this phenomena of tipping caught the imagination of many people, both in the sciences and not. Harry Houdini, the most famous magician of all time, was an avid ghostbuster. He was truly interested in contacting the spirit of his mother who had died. He had been very much wanting to contact her. He went to seances and was appalled at what the tricks that he saw. And so he made a large part of his later career devoted, like our hero Randy here, devoted to exposing the fakes. And these are diagrams from a pamphlet he published illustrating how another medium, under cover of an absolute dark room that only would have worked in the dark, even though her feet and her hands were supposedly under control by the other sitters at the table, she could, under cover of darkness, lean forward, put her head under the edge of the table, and lift up and create the spirit effect. I think there's a really important difference in viewpoint between some of the scientists that investigated these psychic phenomena and the magicians that investigated. Crookes and Zollner and others who investigated the psychic phenomena, for the most part, were not trained in deception, not trained in magic, not trained to look for that sort of thing, and often they put their focus on sort of weaker controls and letting the medium do pretty much whatever they wanted to do, whereas the magicians like Houdini and some others put more stringent controls on and really went in looking for tricks. There were many magicians who were on the skeptical side of things. I won't talk about them in any length here, but Grace had mentioned John Mulholland, the spirit that I contacted at that seance. Mulholland had been a bit of a ghostbuster himself. Beware Familiar Spirits was a nice book of his. And magicians, even when they were not active ghostbusters, were certainly willing to make use of these themes in their shows. But here is an engraving from 1853 that sort of illustrates what might have gone on in a sophisticated party of the day. And you see right in the center of the image, we've got people, men and women alike, putting their hands around a small table, engaged in an exercise in table tipping. And this was something that few scientists really wanted to understand. Michael Faraday, perhaps the most prominent physicist of his day, was absolutely fascinated by this, and he put not one moment's credence in the idea that it was spooks. He was convinced that there was something else going on here. Even when people weren't doing trickery, he thought there might be an interesting phenomena to investigate. Let me just read a brief quote. I think I've got, I'm not entirely sure how to get my notes down here. There we go. This gives you an idea of his skeptical attitude. He was finding fault with the great body of the population who, quote, reject all consideration of the quality of cause and effect, who refer the causes to electricity and magnetism, who yet know nothing of these laws or of these forces, who even refer them to diabolical or supernatural agency rather than suspend their judgment or acknowledge to themselves that they are not learned enough in these matters to decide on the nature of the phenomena. So he was surely a skeptic, but he was a skeptic that wanted to investigate with some rigor. So what did he do? What would you do? If you wanted to investigate this phenomenon of table tipping and test the idea, is it spirits or is it something else? What would you do? Pardon me? Turn on the lights? Okay. The lights were on in many of these cases. And the table tipping, it could be a room like you saw at the party. Remove the tablecloth. He did things like that. And indeed, a tablecloth wasn't necessary. In fact, it was often just a bare wooden table. Cleared glass table to look for trickery. Okay, good idea. Move the people away? Well, okay, but the claim was it only happened when they put their hands on the table. Sure. So, yes. Ah, good idea. In fact, you're very much, if you will, in the spirit of what he was coming up with. Good idea. So what he suggested was that what if you put pieces of paper on the table between the hands and the wood, and therefore you could better understand when the hands were pushing on something. And that's very much the thinking that Faraday used. Here's what he actually did. He wrote this up and published it in 1853 in a British magazine called the Athenaeum. He devised a whole series of tests, and my favorite is the first one he did. It's the simplest, in which he took, he says, four or five pieces of cardboard, slippery cardboard. This isn't so slippery. This is a non-working model of what he did. But he took four or five pieces of cardboard and stuck them together with wax cement and lined them all up, put a piece of sandpaper on the bottom, and made sure the biggest one, the top one, was a little bigger than all the rest so that it hid the edges. What he did was he put this on the tabletop and had the sitters put their hands on the cardboard. Ah, right. You understand? Here was his reasoning, and this is what proved to be. He broke this down to here's my research question. Are the spirits moving this? He translated that to a hypothesis. First hypothesis, no, it's not the spirits, it's the people pushing it. Alternative hypothesis, okay, it's the spirits. He set up this mechanism, this device, with a slippery cardboard so that he reasoned this way. He said, if it's the spirits, then the force starts at the table and the people are following however it moves. On the other hand, if the force is coming from the people, they're pushing the cardboard, and the cardboard and the sandpaper are pulling the table along with it. By doing this experiment with sincere people, he was very clear in his write-up that he had ruled out trickery for most of what he was investigating. He was investigating those cases where this happened with sincere, honest believers who had no idea that they were actually doing anything themselves. He was able to demonstrate with a cardboard that when the table moved, the cardboard slid, and when they turned it over, they could see that the cards at the top had slid the most, and as you went down the stack, less and less movement, so that the you could tell the direction the force had initiated at the top, the hands had pushed it, move the top layer a lot, the next layer a little bit, the bottom layer at least of all, and demonstrated that the source of the motion started with the hands. And he built more and more elaborate mechanisms like this, and one of the interesting things was that he gave visual feedback. When he let the people see that they were pushing it, when he made a sensor that let them know when they were pushing, it wouldn't move at all. The people weren't trying, just like with a pendulum. They were not deliberately trying to deceive, they were simply deceiving themselves. So he was an innovator in this kind of investigation. Here's that picture again. Look what's going on that side of the room. The same party where the table tipping was going on in the middle, right here. She has a pendulum. These two phenomena were going on at the very same time, often in the very same room. And Grace is going to talk a little bit about another scientist who investigated this side of the picture.
Did I miss it? Okay. All right. Chevrel was a chemist, a Frenchman, a very, very famous chemist in France. He's renowned. I don't know why we don't know about him here, but I can tell you some of his major accomplishments so you get a sense that he was an important person in his time. He spent a decade of his life working in the lab to understand animal fats, to break it down, to understand what fatty acids were, to understand how soap works, and an important thing he did was create margarine, which I believe the French chefs of the world have yet to forgive him. But in his day, in 1812, in fact, he was invited to observe in a lab someone holding a pendulum over water, and the relationship of the pendulum to the water caused it to move. But when a barrier, a pane of glass, was put between them, the movement stopped, interfering with the relationship between the pendulum and the material in the bowl. And yes, there was water, there was mercury, many, many different materials were used, but the relationship of the pendulum to what was in the bowl was consistent. And he was invited to come up and to repeat what he had just seen. And much to his surprise, it worked for him too. When he held the pendulum, it moved. And when the pane of glass was put in place, it stopped. But what made him special, different, a scientist, was that he thought there had to be maybe another reason. Maybe it's more than the pendulum in a relationship with a substance. So he asked himself, what could be happening? What could make this happen so consistently? And one of the questions he asked himself is, could I be moving it without realizing I'm moving it? And so he developed two really interesting tests to test that. First, he built a wooden rest, and he held it here and slowly moved it down his arm. And as it moved down, the movement got smaller and smaller and smaller. And when the rest was under his fingers, the movement stopped. But as he moved the rest back, the movement became greater again. And it made him think it must, you know, there's something he's doing that the rest prevented. And so he returned to the experiment that had been done over and over again that he'd been very successful with. You know, when I hold the pendulum over the substance, it moves. But when a pane of glass is put between, it stops. Only this time, he was blindfolded, and his assistant moved the pane of glass without him knowing when it was there and when it wasn't. And without the feedback of knowing, expecting the movement because he could see the liquid, it didn't work. And so he actually wrote this finding up. He initially had an open letter where he discussed this, but later in his life, he wrote it up in a formal paper in the 1860s with other skeptical things that he did. One of the things I want to point out to you is he lived to be 102, and he worked for most of those years. He retired, I think, when he was 92 from leading the Museum of Natural History. So, Mr. Randy, you're just a whippersnapper, and you have a long time yet to go. So, now it's time for you to work. We have three modern devices that make extraordinary claims, like table tipping and the spirits moving pendulums. And we would like you to think about how you might test them. So, the first is the truth seeker. We have brought this to you sparing no expense, since we actually did spend the $149 to buy it.
From Sharper Image, 1998 catalog.
Patent pending circuitry. It claims to be able to read stress in the voice, and stress indicates a lack of truthfulness. And so you can have it on your desk, and as people come and go with your conversations during the day, you can judge whether they're being forthright or not. You're able to adjust it for background noise and things like that. So that's our device number one. Device number two is the Eggly wheel. This helps you measure your life energy. And through feedback from your experiments with it, you can increase your life's energy.
The idea is you cup your hand around it like in the photo there, and your vital force will eventually start the wheel to turning, and the little meter down here will measure the rate of turn, and the faster it spins, the stronger your life energy.
And then our third device is Verminex. So you plug this in, and it exhibits a high-pitched tone humans can't hear. But those spiders and mice, and probably your dogs, might be unhappy. This is the cheapest of our devices. I do want to point out there's one really important thing that all these devices have in common. They have LEDs. And so we want to break you up into teams. You can come up and look at these, but please leave them here because all the teams are going to want to look at it. We're going to assign you a device so that each of the devices has... So what your jobs will be is to define the claim that's being made, to translate it into a testable hypothesis, to define what your outcomes would be, what is success, what is failure, to identify the limits of your test, and what the protocols, the important protocol points would be. So, Chip, do you want to break them up?
Yeah, let's see. This is a large group here, so let's see how we can best do this. And I know there are handouts going around the room. I don't know if we had about 100 handouts printed. I don't know how many... but at least we should break into groups so that every group has at least a couple of copies of this. The handout basically describes the basic instructions that come with each of these three devices. So what I suggest is that folks, maybe like two rows at a time, sort of pull yourself apart from the group, maybe move your chairs around, and sort of take this in terms of like two rows, two rows, two rows, two rows. And so... All right, so just to recap... For the video folks here, we've talked about three devices. The truth seeker lie detector that allegedly measures level of stress in the voice. The Egli wheel, which allegedly measures vital energy, whatever that means. And finally, the Verminex, which is supposed to emit its own energy, its own ultrasonic energy, and repel those pesky mice and other critters that we don't want around here. So I'd like to ask for... Let's start with the truth seeker. Is there a group that would like to talk a little bit about your process and what you'd like to do the testing? Yes.
I've noticed at the front of the building here, masses of rodents running down the street. I don't understand it.
Bring over the truth seeker.
Pay no attention to what I just said.
Yeah. Okay, so do we have a spokesperson for the truth seeker group? Please come up to the mic. All right, so what are the hypotheses that your group was focused on?
We were focused on a lot of different things of what the machine could potentially measure, whether it's actual stress or just voice tone, volume, anything, pitch, yes. And we decided to just simplify the experiment as to simply, are you telling the truth or not? Is it living up to its claim as a truth seeker?
Good. Okay.
So number two, measurable outcomes between a success and failure obviously would be, can it tell the truth? Unfortunately, it's not entirely a binary thing. There's a range, but for simplicity's sake, we figured just, you know, yes or no. Is it telling the truth? Are you telling the truth? Are you lying? So the protocol we decided on was that first, blinding is very important. We have to make sure that the subject does not know if they're actually, well, what they're being tested on. And so we decided to have on... at least for one sample group, and possibly, you know, multiple samples perhaps, but at least for one sample group, have a simple statement such as, I have a daughter, or I am 30 years old, or I am a woman, and have all the samples read the same statement, and have it be a 50-50 split between, you know, say if you have 50 men and 50 women, and they all say, I am a man, obviously half of them are lying, and see what the results of that test would be. So that would be a simplistic protocol. And then you could also vary if you have more subjects and resources for things like pitch, volume, if they're under stress, maybe have them do some jumping jacks or something like that.
Okay, great. Now, limitations. Does anyone see a limitation with the protocol that they talked about here?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mention all the details. Basically, the testees would not know what the test is. They would just be handed a slip of paper, read this, and then exit the room. And then another group of the testers would just mark, you know, this subject got red, this subject got green, etc. So yeah.
Okay. Okay. Randy? Here, speak to my microphone.
All right. I see a problem in that the people who are undergoing the test are not necessarily under a stress
exactly.
of some kind. And that's critical to a thing like this. Am I a man or a woman? Well, with me, it's a different matter. But first of all, it's obvious. I don't want to get into the details. The point is, if you're not under test conditions of stress of some kind, I don't think this test would be adequate.
Yeah.
We also thought of that. We decided that is, in fact, the limitation of that test. But also to perhaps randomize, and I don't know how robust this would be, but basically you could also say, please answer this question, state your gender, but decide on your own, lie or not. Say I'm a man or you're a woman, and then exit the room. And then after exiting, check saying I lied, I told the truth. And having a separate sample that way and compare it against the first baseline sample of someone just reading a piece of paper.
Okay, good. We did this similar exercise with this device at a workshop a few years ago, and one of the groups came up with a way to put the subject under stress, and they actually demonstrated it in the room. Someone stood there, the person speaking was seated, the person who was lying or telling the truth was seated, and there was someone else over them with a pitcher of ice water ready to pour. Someone got dunked before the day was out.
Okay. The next device, the Eggly Wheel. Who would like to pour it out?
Okay, come to the microphone, please.
You're not alone. There were other people working on the wheel.
There was too much to talk about. We didn't have much time. I guess the big issues that we came up with were trying to isolate it from potential input other than life force, like whether or not there was wind affecting it, whether or not temperature was a factor, whether or not magnetism or capacitance were factors. I think we spent a lot of time doing that. I don't have anything else. Sorry.
Anyone else on the Eggly Wheel?
So our hypothesis was the subject vitality should be the same in any given moment. And so the measurable, observable outcomes distinguished between success and failure would be to take two devices, have the person cup both devices, and make sure that they have the same reading. So the protocol, of course, would be, you know, place two devices on two separate tables. We had some concerns about the pulse of the person might be causing micro vibrations to affect the thing. So we wanted to put it on two different surfaces. We talked about the idea of temperature. If we could somehow control for temperature, you know, place a hot cup of coffee near one of the devices and a cold ice cup near a different one. And some of the limitations of the test that we found is there might be manufacturing defects in the equipment. So we're not actually using the same device to measure the thing. The article we said talked about that you could measure with two hands, you'll have different readings, but they also said to test separately. So that's why we think the two-hand might be the best approach.
Okay, cool.
We have another contributor.
Yeah. Because the dimension's about a zillion and one variables, and it basically covers all the bases so that you could never test any individual thing. One thing that one person in our group picked up on is that there's a claim on the page that says that 100% life reading is the average. So a very easy, very testable thing is to just gather up enough people, and if it's an average, some of them will be stressed, some of them will be happy, some of them will be sad, and it won't matter. If it measures at 100%, then you go on to test other things, but it at least sort of like you could start to criticize the device and its claims from that.
Yeah, this one's a tough one because the claims are so vague. It's hard to actually pin it down. And that's often the case when Randy is dealing with folks from the million dollar million-dollar challenge, that the claims that people come to us with are often so ill-defined, nonspecific, that it's hard to come up with a reasonable test. Yes?
The young lady wanted to...
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Greg.
You wanted to say something?
Hey, I was pretty much going to say exactly what you were saying. We stumbled on the first block because defining the claim is pretty much impossible. Like, vital energy, we don't know what it is. They're not going to tell us what it is. I flipped through the booklet. It never really defines what it is. So I think the idea of the average of 100% is the closest we can get, because that's the closest thing to an actual claim that they make. But
I tested myself this morning. I was only a 20, so...
But all their literature goes to people who already believe in the device and what it does. It's all about your advice for you if you do have a low reading, like you. Maybe mm-hmm. you could change your diet, the booklet suggests.
Or spend less time in the Del Mar Lounge.
Exactly. So, I mean, to actually pin them down to get them to define a claim is more or less impossible. And also, I'd want to take the box apart.
Ah.
That was another thing our group said. So, without actually looking inside it, I don't know.
Yeah, great. Thank you. There had been someone else. Yes, real quick, please.
Besides defining the claim of vitality, which none of us could agree upon, we thought there would be an overly elaborate way we could sort of isolate groups of people, like the athletic people, average, and people that are ill of a specific way, and just sort of see how the device reacts to each and every one of them. That it still wouldn't really define what, I, of course, vitality actually is, and why is that sitting there? It wouldn't really define what vitality is, but it would at least give us an idea of a control, especially separating, of course, men and women in each different subset groups. We also thought of isolating the device in a vacuum, like a glass vacuum, and seeing how it would react to specific scenarios. If it would just be in a vacuum and you would move your hand close to it, it would be within a few inches, but yet still be in a vacuum, would it still react to you? And what happens if we sort of create a device that is very similar at 98.6 degrees, runs water, and has the same sort of gelatinous substance of a hand, and keep it nearby to see if it would react in the same way?
It's a cool idea.
Okay.
Yeah. And one last quick comment on this one, then we'll get to Verminex. All three of these devices are things that I've used in a class that I've taught at the University of Maryland, and I would make this an assignment. Yeah. I would make this an assignment. Every time I taught, one of the assignments was to design a protocol for something, and several years I used these three things here that you folks have had 20 minutes to think about. I would give it to the students to work on for a few days and see what they came up with. Some interesting things came out of that. Go ahead.
I would actually like to say that I believe that they make a very good claim. They make a claim, it's just that it's not, they say that it's the vital force that moves it. They make that claim. They just don't define vital force for us. And they, even if we could make the test with all of us here and we should come to an average of 100, that wouldn't show anything more than that maybe the calibration of the tool wasn't right. It wouldn't really say anything about the claim they are making. The claim they are making basically is saying that there is a vital force that goes beyond what we normally can measure, and that they have found a way of measuring it with this meter. So it's much more complicated than that. And I mean, they claim a change direction with which hand you use and stuff like that. And to come up with something that is even close to what we can do in 20 minutes is hard. But they're making a claim. They're making the claim that it's that vital force that will turn it.
Okay, great. Thank you. Oh! Whoops. We just lost the plug on the mic. All right, so
very quickly, we're almost out of time, but is there a group that worked on the Verminex that would like to come up and tell us how you would approach that?
Here. There's a mic on the table. You can come up to the table. Oh, here comes our Verminex man.
Is this on?
Just speak into
yep.
it.
Okay, so we worked on Verminex. And they make several claims. But, you know, most of them have to do with what Verminex actually does, how it's acting on the vermin, that it works at a high frequency, that it affects a nervous system. But none of those are important unless it does what you want it to do in your home, which is get rid of the vermin. So unless it does that, it doesn't matter how it's doing it. And it also was brought up in our group that you could probably solve all those other things by a quick Google search. You can find out, you know, what frequency these insects or mice can hear at and all those things. So what we wanted to do is come up with a protocol for testing whether or not vermin actually do respond or have an adverse reaction to this high-pitched frequency. And we came up with a simple experiment where you just, you know, you create a controlled environment, you put your vermin in there, the insects or the mice or whatever. You can have, maybe you have two Verminex, one on either side, and one's operational, one is not, and just watch to see if they have, you know, a preference for one side or the other. Unlike some of these other devices, it's actually a pretty simple and straightforward claim. Either it gets rid of them or it doesn't. And I guess some limitations of that test, if I can just keep moving through it. Yeah, please. Right, you could test it on right different kinds of vermin as well. I think we have another comment.
And what I like about you suggested something that I think has a great potential. You said have one device active, one device not. That would lend itself to actually setting up a randomized double-blind situation.
Right, you have one experimenter set it up, and then you have different people observe it, and you would also keep the LED active on both of them.
Right.
Right. Because we can't hear it is the idea, but you would still see the light. Sorry, there was a comment, right?
It didn't work.
They make the price low enough that it's worth a try, exactly.
Yeah.
It's painless, so there's no guilt associated with it. And then also, unlike in the controlled experiment, you're not very likely to see, you know, very dramatic results in your home, at least not very quickly.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank
all.
You. All right.
Well, good job.
Yeah, nicely done. All right. If I could just sort of wind this down, I know it's time for lunch, but I want to bring it back to Faraday for a moment. Faraday, in his report on his testing of table tipping, said, "I think the system of education that could leave the mental condition of the public body in the state in which this subject has found it must have been greatly deficient in some important principle." He really emphasized the criticality of events like this and getting materials into the schools and working with folks to educate them about how the world works and how to think critically. There's an old Welsh prayer that goes, "From ghoulies and ghosties and long-leggedy beasties and things that go bump in the night, good Lord, deliver me." Well, okay. But rather than a prayer, I suggest that education and scientific skepticism are the best nightlights that we have to get rid of the spooks. Thank you.